Put your hand on it and say, this is God's holy word. God's going to speak to me tonight. And He's going to change my life forever. The word is anointed. Holy men of old spoke as they were moved upon by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in and upon Kubis to teach me, in and all over me, to be able to hear and understand. Lord, let freedom reign in my life. Right, maybe I should just say, you know, when God opened the word of grace to me in 1981, I was sitting next to a dam and I was so caught up in the Spirit of God, and I was literally caught up to where they brought the woman that was caught in the act of adultery in front of Jesus in the temple, and they threw her in front of Jesus. It was so real that I actually smelled the dust all around their feet, and I saw them, you know, with angry faces, pointing fingers. And then Jesus wrote in the ground and he said, you know, he that is without sin cast the first stone. And, you know, nobody was there to accuse. And Jesus turned around and said, woman, where are those thine accusers? And she stood up and said, none here, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. And God opened it. If there's no accusation, then it means there's no judgment. If there's no judgment, there's no condemnation. But first, there needs to be accusation. Somebody needs to be accused before they can be judged, before they can be condemned. These people accused the woman. And when Jesus said, where are your accusers? He said, none, your Lord. Then he said, then in other words, there can't be a courtroom case. I can't judge you. Therefore, he spoke the end result. Therefore, he said, neither do I condemn you. And God opened to me and he said, my grace overruled my law when I wrote in the dust, because the finger of God wrote the law in stones. And then the finger of God wrote in the dust, and the consciences of the people were awoken. And he said, my grace overruled my law when I wrote in the dust. And he said in Ezekiel, I will take the heart of stone out and I will put a heart of flesh in the inside of you. And I will write my laws in your heart and in your mind, and you will understand my ways and you will walk in them. And then, you know, what jumped up to me was John chapter 1, where it says in verse 14, the word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace. And out of his fullness have we all received, yes, grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Okay, so the law came, but grace also came. So we need to understand, what do we want, the law, or do we want to sit under grace? Now, the grace thing is so important. In the last couple of years, we've seen it on TV, we've heard preachers, everybody's now on the grace wagon. It's a good wagon to be on, okay? But the message of grace is so important that every epistle that Paul wrote, you know, right there from Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, Thessalonians, you know, right through every single epistle, in the first two verses or three verses, either verse 2 or verse 3, Paul says, peace be unto you. And then in the closing verses of every single epistle, Paul says, grace be with you. So he starts off by grace be to you, and he closes by grace be with you. You know, Peter just blew the whole thing up. He says in 1 Peter and in 2 Peter, he starts off like this, may grace and peace be multiplied unto you. Then the book of Revelation comes, you know, grace be unto you. It starts off with, and the Bible closes with Revelation 22, 21. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. I mean, so what must be the important message if the Bible closes like this? Every epistle starts with that. Every epistle closes with that. Then grace must be very important tonight. Galatians chapter 2. It's going to rip you apart, man. Amen. It just says in verse 21, therefore, I do not treat God's gracious gift as something of minor importance and defeat its purpose. I do not set aside and invalidate and frustrate and nullify the grace, the unmerited favor of God. For if justification, righteousness, acquittal from guilt comes through observing the ritual of the law, then Christ the Messiah died groundlessly and to no purpose and in vain. His death was then wholly superfluous. There's an old story that says, you have heard it. Oh, don't want to take the line. God's riches at Christ's expense. I made a poster once when God revealed to me in 1981. And I remember it was my father-in-law that was with me, and he started complaining about stuff and said, you know, when I read Bible, I feel so terrible. I feel so wicked. I feel so bad. I said, Dad, you know you're wrong. I said, you're actually worse. You know, and it was like a shock in the house. I said, you know what? You're actually worse. I said, that's why he died. And then God gave me the revelation. Jesus will help me. I said, grace means you cannot be good enough to make it. That means you cannot be bad enough to miss it. Try it from the other way. You cannot be bad enough to miss it. Therefore, you cannot be good enough to make it. Okay. Acts chapter 4, verse 33. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Now, why was great grace upon the people? Because with great power the apostles gave witness. Why did they with great power gave witness of the resurrection? And why was great grace upon the people? In Acts chapter 3, remember Peter and John is on the way to the temple at the hour of prayer. And as they come, here's the man sitting as normal, you know, begging. And they come by and, you know, looking at them, you know, expecting something from them. Said, give me alms. Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have given unto you. You know the story. Some don't, but some do. And he says, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. He took the man by the hands, raised him up, and his ankle bones received strength. And he jumped up and ran, you know, there in the Solomon's porch. And the people were excited. And Peter said something. You got to read this. Verse 12 says, and when Peter saw it, this is now the people running, screaming, shouting. He answered the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Oh, why look you so earnestly on us as though by our own power, or I want to add by our own holiness, we had made this man walk? Hey, it's not our good deeds. It's not our good performance. It's not how holy we are. It's not how great we have achieved. It's not for achievers. It's for believers. It's not our good works. It's not our holiness. I'm trying to build up to that verse. You know, it says, but the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and this is the last time it's used from there, it's the God of our Lord Jesus, hath glorified his son whom you delivered up and denied him in the presence. Okay, and verse 16, and his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong that's standing here before you. Verse 19, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Now I want to say, if we see this great power, if we realize the great things that God is doing, if we realize that God is gracious and he wants his grace to be outpoured in our lives, God is gonna bring times of refreshing into your life. God is gonna bring, I'm prophesying, God is bringing times of refreshing into your life. times of refreshing. Things that look dead is going to come alive. Things that look sick is going to be well. Things that look poor is going to prosper. God is going to lift you up, and it's not your good works. It's not your holiness. It's not your performance. It's all by grace. Okay, chapter 4, verse 7. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name? Listen, we go into that power of chapter 4, verse 33. By great power the apostles gave witness, and great grace was upon them. Remember where we're going, okay? And they asked them, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said, Verse 10, be it known unto you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand before you whole. Verse 33 says, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, and great grace was upon them. So there's three things here. There was great power, there's the resurrection of the dead, and there's great grace. Okay, so every time they said, this Jesus you crucified, God raised him, that's why you now see this. It's not us, it's not our good works, it's not our holiness. You crucified Jesus, God raised him, now you see this power. In other words, I believe it's by grace I'm saved, through faith. It's not anything of myself, so that no man can boast. It's glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. The Word was made flesh and dwelled amongst us. We beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Okay, the law was given by Moses, grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Out of his fullness have we all received grace for grace. It was amazing grace, how sweet the sounds good that saved someone like me. I once was lost, but now even if you can't sing, it still makes sense. Yes. Okay? And then these guys say to the disciples, you shall not speak in this name again. We forbid you to speak in his name again. Then they ran to the other disciples and they started praying. Verse 29. And they said, now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word. Okay, just keep it there. I think it's verse 13. Chapter 4, verse 13. This is now in front of the Sanhedrin. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. I want to tell you, spend some time with Jesus. Ask him for boldness. You will come to the front. You will speak the word of God with boldness. And God will reward you with signs and with wonders. God will come to your aid. God will break you through. God will prosper you. God will heal you. God will bless you. God will touch you. God will do something for you that is greater than yourself. Boldness because they had been with Jesus. And here they come and they say, oh God, grant unto your servants boldness to speak your words. Verse 30, by stretching, remember to speak your word, by stretching forth your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of your holy child Jesus. Verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Okay, great power. signs, wonders, miracles, and healings. All because Jesus is risen. All because they had boldness to speak the word. And all of this I thought that was too awesome. Let's go to chapter 11, verse 23. Who, when he came and had seen the grace of God. Okay, now we just had great grace upon the people. Now here is somebody by the name of Barnabas. He came and he saw the grace of God. He was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. Peter is now still in Jerusalem. He's on the top of a house, lunchtime, and he's praying and fasting. Smell of the food puts him in a trance. He starts visualizing a sheet with animals that can be eaten, but he's not allowed to eat them. And he sees bacon and Vienna and salami. All the stuff that you're not allowed to eat. And you don't have to see it the way I see it, but you know, Peter's on the rooftop, it is lunchtime, and he does see the vision of all this unclean stuff, and pork chops, and I can hear it here and there, but it's not all over, you know, back bacon, thick slice pieces in, two eggs with it, and he's, and a voice says, Peter, eat. He says, never. He's trying to be so holy, but he knows in his heart, if I can put my mouth there, you know. And God says, Peter, three times it happens, and every time, you know, he smells, you know, imagine the smoke coming up here. Peter's on the roof, the kitchen's just beneath him, and Peter's caught up. And the voice says, Peter, eat. He says, never. I'll never eat any unclean thing. And God says, I got your attention. There's three men at the gate. Go with them. And you know, and this is all happening because there's a man by the name of Cornelius. He's praying. He's Italian. So he eats salami. He eats viennas. He eats bacon, you know, and he gets a vision. And an angel says, go send for Simon called Peter. He's in the house of Simon, the tanner, and he will come tell you the way of salvation. So here he comes, and, you know, Peter comes down, and he goes with him, comes in the house of Cornelius. Cornelius falls down. Peter says, no, stand up, and he starts preaching to his household. And here in verse 44, 30, 45 of chapter 10, while Peter was yet speaking, the Holy Ghost fell on all these Italians. I mean, they still sitting there, in nomine Patri et Filii et Spiritus. I mean, the Italians. Here the Holy Spirit falls on them all. They're all filled with the Holy Ghost, start speaking in other tongues. Peter said, oh my goodness, you know, oh my goodness, what can I do? And Peter is so shocked that he just started baptizing them. And this is where the story is picked up. Peter is now speaking to the rest of the disciples in Jerusalem. Verse 15. And as I began to speak, Peter's now trying to tell them, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us in the beginning. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how he said that John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. For as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? Huh? Okay, I don't want to say too deep. That means many people today are withstanding God because they can't allow the Spirit to move in other churches and on other people and on other races and on other denominations. It's just us. We are the holy. We are the righteous. I mean, a Dutch Reformed guy can't be filled with the Spirit. A Roman Catholic can't speak in tongues. Hey, Who are you to withstand God? God can jump walls, man. God can go into any place where he wants to go. Verse 18. When they heard these things, they held their peace and glorified God. You're going to love this. Saying, then God hath also on the Gentiles granted repentance unto life. Verse 21. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Verse 22. Then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church, which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch, who when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad. Come on, we're going to understand grace a little bit deeper. And exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. For he was a good man and full of the Holy Ghost and of faith. And much people was added unto the Lord. Much people. Okay, much people. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for seek to Saul. And when he had found them, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. You're going to get this. And the disciples were called Christians. First time. I mean, the Holy Ghost was poured out on all the disciples. They all spoke in tongues. I mean, they had glory. They had revival. And years later, Paul and Barnabas was called Christians. Nobody else. They were just called disciples. And for the first time, they said, these people are just like Christ. These people are just like Christ. These people. Why? Because Barnabas saw the grace of God, that God doesn't care from which tongue you are. God doesn't care from which race you are. God doesn't care. Oh, sorry, I'm doing it. God doesn't care from which denomination you are. The grace of God is for everybody, all ages, all tongues, all tribes, all nations, all denominations. Grace, 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 unmerited favor. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Chapter 13. Now, when the congregation was broken up, we'll read it now. Many of the Jews and religious proselytes, okay, this means this is different groups, different doctrines, followed Paul and Barnabas. Okay, this is just the next chapter, people. Followed Paul and Barnabas, who speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. When Paul and Barnabas came, Jews, religious proselytes, different culture groups came together and said, what's this? What's this? They said, hey, this is what we want to ask you. Just continue in the grace. Don't start going back to your Jewish thing. Don't go back to your religious thing. Don't go back to your proselyte thing. Don't go back to your this thing. Don't go back. Just continue in the grace of God. This is all we want to admit. Thank you. It was so powerful. Verse 44 says, the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. Nearly the whole city came because they heard something that they never heard, because everybody wants to make disciples for their own group. And here comes somebody and says, no, not that, not that, not that, not that grace. But he whom God raised again saw no corruption. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. Beware therefore, beware, lest that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. Behold, ye despisers, and wonder, and perish. For I work a work in your days, a work which you shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you. And when the Jews were gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles, besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Now, when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. And the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. Is there anybody in this house that says, oh Lord, I can hear? I want to write, I want to walk, I want to talk, I want to refer, I want to preach. I've got so much to do and I can't do it all in one night. So I got to stick to the word of grace. That means eternity. How are we ever going to fathom the depth of God's grace? You know, in 2006, when we were in Ireland on top of Mount Slemish, where Patrick met the Lord Jesus Christ at the age of 16, became the patron saint of Ireland. You know, God spoke to me and said, I've been teaching you grace since 1981. I've been teaching you my mercy for the last 4 years. That was 2006. God says, when you truly understand this grace of mine, I will start revealing my love to you. He says, but people can't be ready for my love message because they're still struggling with my grace message. But once you understand my grace, you will start stepping into my love. And when love comes, that is perfection. And when perfection comes, that is the manifestation of the Christ on the earth, the manifestation of the sons. That is what creation is longing for. When that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away with. So Paul is preaching. He says, man, God's going to work a work in your days. That it's so great. He's talking about grace. The emphasis we're on. Just continue in the grace. Don't go stick to your religion. Don't go stick to your denomination. Don't go stick to what you learned from a child. Because Mark chapter 7:13 says, Jesus says, because of your tradition, you will make the word of God of no effect. Are we going to stick to what we were brought up with? Or are we going to take the word and say, Lord, teach me thy word. Let the Spirit come and reveal the truth of thy word. I want to know the grace. I want to understand the grace. But I'm going to have it for me, but I'm going to have it for you. And I'm going to have it for you. I'm going to have it for you. I want to have the grace. Not just amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me, but that saved a wretch like you. Do you think I was the only stinking, rotten sinner? Or maybe you were one too? You know, you see, you know what he did? I wonder what you did, you know? What will happen if we read your life story, you know? Maybe yours was not so open. Maybe yours was secret. But, you know, Jesus says your thoughts, you know, reveals the intents of your heart. You know, so many times people don't speak, but they already thought. God is doing a work in our days. That is so great that even if people start telling us it's difficult to believe. What is this great thing? That God want to forgive all your sins. He want to justify you from everything that the law of Moses could not justify. So any guilt, any condemnation, okay? But it's not just the guilt and the condemnation. It's the thing itself. God want to set you free from the sin thing itself, from the act itself. Yeah. That woman was caught in the act of adultery. Amen. Jesus didn't just set her free from the accusation. He didn't just set her free from the judgment. He didn't just set her free from the condemnation. He set her free from the very act. When that woman walked out, Jesus said, now go and sin no more. He didn't say to her, watch out that you sin no more. He said to her, go and sin no more. So go and don't do it again. In other words, go and you will not be able to do it again because I took away your judgment. I took away your accusation. I took away your condemnation, you know. And you go read it directly in the book and the word of the Almighty God. It's not, don't do that, don't do that. It's, I say unto you, don't do it again. In other words, you won't do it. Everything that you could not be justified by the law of Moses. It's so great that even if somebody tells it to you, you will struggle to believe it. In other words, grace says, I don't want to just free your mind. I want to free you. I don't want to just free your heart. I want to free you. I don't want to just free your tongue. I want to free you. I don't want to just free you from the thought. I want to free you from the very act. This is called grace. And when the people heard it, the next Sabbath, the whole city came together and said, tell us to, tell us to, tell us to. Okay. You know what happened the next minute? They wanted to stone them, kill them, and say, you don't say this in our church. Chapter 14, verse 3. Long time, therefore, abode they speaking boldly. Remember where we started, in the Lord. Which gave, I love this one, which gave testimony unto the word of grace and granted signs, wonders to be done by their hands. Oh, man, God. That's what they prayed in chapter 4. Give us boldness to speak your word, that your hand will be stretched out with healing, signs, wonders, and miracles in the name of your holy child, Jesus. And when they spoke the word of God boldly, great wonders, great power, and great grace. Now, when they spoke the grace, God witnessed the word of grace and granted signs, wonders, miracles. I mean, we always had healings since the day I got saved. You know, my first miracle was when Don prayed for me. I struggled with sinus since I was a small boy. Man, I was so sick. I had pipes put in my nose when I was 16. And every day I had to go and they had to drain the stuff. I had operations. I walked around with two handkerchiefs in my side pockets, two in my back pockets. I was so embarrassed whenever I walked. My nose was always running. I'm telling you, sick. No joke. At the age of 21, Don came into my house. I was lying in the bed, sick, sick, sick. And he came in there and said, can I pray for you? And I said something. He laid his hands on me and said, I rebuke this foul sinusitis and I command it to leave. I'm standing here today. I'm 60 years of age. I never had sinus again free till today. My first miracle. And then I got saved and I started praying for the sick. One of the first people I prayed for was a woman in a wheelchair, 72 years old, born a cripple, and she got out of a wheelchair and walked. A woman that could hardly see, I gave her the Bible that she started reading. This was 2 weeks after I got saved. So we always had miracles. We pitched our tent in 1982. On the Soutpansberg there at Louis Trichardt, preached the tent there and preached there. And I remember the first night, a woman came in on crutches. A boy came in on crutches. They were both healed. A dumb woman started talking. A deaf guy started hearing. You know, miracles, miracles forever. And then in 2000, I was in a meeting up in Africa. And I stood there, and a man got out of a wheelchair. And I stood there, and Connie was with us. And there was a camera on both sides. One camera was taking the guy that was praying for the sick. The other camera was taking me on the other side of the sick. And here was the crippled guy in between us. So both cameras was edited afterwards into the same thing. And when this guy got out of the wheelchair, the other guy looks into my face. Now there's two cameras. And he said, it's by grace. Yes. And I stood on this side. I said, then I can do it. Yes. We watched the videos afterwards over and over and over. And I came here and I said, I can do it. And I got a prophetic word. You will go to South Africa and they will bring the cripples and they will walk. And here from 2000 to about 2008, 14,000 cripples on DVD were walking, and we stopped counting and said, God, is it possible? He said, it's not your good works, It's not your holiness. It's because you really grasp grace. And if it will be told, the people will struggle to believe, because it's not how good you are. It's not how bad you are. It's there is therefore now no condemnation. Where is your accuser? He don't want to set you free from the thought and the accusation. He want to set you free from the very act. He want to set you free from the deed. He want to set you free from the thing itself. Maybe somebody here is not condemned anymore about your smoking, but you're still smoking. That is not what I'm talking about. That is a lie. That is cheating on grace. He wants, Paul says, I will not frustrate the grace. He don't want you to set you, oh, not condemned. So. No, he wants to set you free from the thing too. Can you allow, I said it to some people, can you allow a little stick that long? I mean, think of it. Here is a beautiful land. It's just the most awesome trees. Oh, man. I mean, it's raw land. Look at it. Wow. And here comes the guy and he buys that place called a wild game farm. And he decides he's going to be a farmer. So he gets all these very expensive tractors. Those big bulldozers, forgive me. You know, all these implements that cost millions of rands. And they come and pull out these trees. Man, and they clean all these acres of lands. And then they start plowing. And this guy says, I'm going to make a farm here. And then they start putting fertilizer in the ground. And then they buy seed from, you know, the cooperation. It costs millions to have that cooperation running every year. Oh, I mean, it costs millions to have all the different kinds of seed for all the different kinds of farmers. Man, and it costs millions to keep all the people employed, to keep the seed, to sell it over the counters, and for farmers to come buy it, or to buy, to travel with very expensive trucks, to go to their farms that's there in the distance. It costs petrol and diesel to get there. And then they spend millions, you know, to get that tractors and plow and the planters to plant. And then they pray to God for rain. And then they spend millions to get all these other tractors to go through. And they take the weeds out and they take pesticide and they kill all the insects that want to kill the plants. And then the plants grow up. Oh. And then they got all these other tractors and all these other implements that cost millions of rand. And they take the harvest off the field. And they put it in big trucks that cost millions of rands. And they travel to these other corporations and these other stores that cost millions to put up. And then they have all these workers there and they employ thousands of people that's costing millions of rand per year. And then they take all this harvest and they put it in these stores. And they let it dry there. And after a while, they take it out with other trucks and they send it to another place called a factory that's got millions of rands. And they take all these leaves and they grind it up by implements that cost millions and millions of rands. And there's another place, it's called a plantation. And they've got people. It's costing millions to take those trees off. And they send them to another factory where people are working that's costing millions. And they make paper out of it. And they send that paper to another factory that's costs millions. And they make it fine paper and put it in little pieces. And they send it to another factory where another factory takes this stuff, grind it up, send it to another factory. And both these factories send it to another factory. And they roll it up in little pieces. Things and they, you know, make little, you know, white things, you know, that's about, you know, 10 centimeters long and about, you know, 7-8 centimeters thick in diameter. And they roll this leaves that is now grinded by stuff that's got millions of rand, and the plantations got millions to grow. And they roll it up and they put it, send it to another factory, and they put it in little packets and they seal it in little boxes, and they send it to other factories, and they put it in trucks that's got costing millions, and they have representations, and they send it, you know, to all these warehouses, you know, and then, you know, certain, you know, people come and they buy it, and they put it in shelves in cafes and in restaurants and in malls, you know, and they pack it out there, and people come and they work all their life long every month for their hard labored money, and they get their salary, and they go to the shop that costs thousands to run, and there's people employed there that must get paid, and you travel in your car that's costing you thousands to, you know, keep care of, and you go buy, you know, this stuff, you know, for a few rand, and you put it in your pocket, and you go home with your car that costing money, your money's just been spent, that cost you your sweat every month, and you open this packet that they work so hard with millions of rand to put together, and you throw it in the dustbin, and you take out one of these little sticks that has cost millions of millions to be able to produce from different farms and different factories, and you take it out, you put it in your mouth, and you burn it out. Everybody say out loud, that's dumb. People's going to be set free. Amen. I mentioned one thing. How many other things? You know what they call that? They call that addiction. You do it once, you struggle not to do it twice. You do it three or four times, you can't leave it alone. I can, well, do it. And that's the same with everything that brings addiction into your life. You need something that when somebody tells you, it'll be hard to believe it. You can be justified from everything that the law of Moses could not justify. God wants to set you free from sin, from wickedness, from evil, from judgment, from condemnations. I mentioned one thing, from your thoughts, from your bitterness, from your unforgiveness, from your anger, from your screaming, shouting, cursing. God wants to set you free from your lust, from your evil thoughts. God wants to set you free. It's called grace. We're still in chapter 14. Verse 26, Amplified Bible. And from there they sailed back to Antioch. This is still the same story. Where they had first been commended to the grace of God for the work which they had now completed. I think we should do chapter 13. This is where it started. Now they were in the church that was at Antioch. Certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas, Simeon, that was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, which has been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul, and they ministered to the Lord and fasted. The Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul. Now, this is what we read the whole time, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed. So from there till where we are now was one mission trip. We just read they laid hands on them, and by the Holy Ghost they were sent forth. But when we read here in 14:26, they commended them to the grace of God. In other words, they said, brothers, you go. There's people that need grace. 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 Lay hands on them. Grace. Grace. How many miracles have you seen in Spirit Word Ministries? When I walk around and I say, grace, 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 blessed, blessed, grace, grace, blessed, blessed, grace, grace. And people go out, cripples walk, blind see, deaf hear, cancer disappear, HIV viruses dry out. Blessed, blessed, grace, grace, bless, bless, grace, grace, bless, grace, grace, bless, grace. Somebody bless, grace. 26. And he began to speak boldly. Every time, boldly, boldly, boldly. In the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. And when he was disposed to pass into Achaia, the brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him, who when he was come, helped them much which had believed through grace. Now listen how they believed through grace. For he mightily convinces the Jews, and that publicly, showing by the scriptures that Jesus was Christ. Okay, so if nobody understands, why do I preach like I'm preaching here in this place? Why do I always go the Bible, scriptures, read there, go to Galatians, go to Ephesians, go to Ezekiel? Why do I always try to just stick to the word? Because God's grace is already on his word. The words of God are spirit and they are life. So if we expound on the word, the grace is already involved and intertwined in it. We just have to believe, and it's in believing that we receive grace. I'm going to go to chapter 20, verse 32. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. Again, and now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Now one more time. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give his peace. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. 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 Grace. 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 And Lord, I believe. Come on. Things are possible.
All things are possible.
And Lord, I believe.
And Lord, I believe.
Come on, the grace of God. And Lord, I believe.
Lord, I believe.
Come on, tonight we're going to receive the grace.
All things are.
As something of minor importance and defeat its purpose. I do not set aside and invalidate and frustrate and nullify the grace, the unmerited favor of God. For if justification, righteousness, and acquittal from guilt comes through observing the ritual of the law, then Christ died groundlessly and to no purpose and in vain. His death was then wholly superfluous. It's all by grace. Jesus Christ not only came to set you free from accusation, judgment, and condemnation. He came to set you free from the very deed, from the very act, from the very thing that's called sin, that's called iniquity, that's called impurity, and unholiness. Christ came to set you free from the very thing itself. So many times we want to be set free from the result of the thing. Tonight, grace wants to set you free from the very thing. Yes. And Lord, I receive.
Lord, I receive.
Come on, all things are possible.
All things are possible.
And Lord, I receive. Come on, Lord, I receive.
And Lord, I receive. Lord, I receive. All things are possible. It's Lord, I receive.
And Lord, I tonight. John chapter 1 verse 11 says, He came unto His own, but His own received Him not. Verse 12 says, But as many as believed on Him, unto them gave He power to become the sons of God, as many as received Him. Verse 13 says, And they owe their birth not to blood, neither to the flesh, neither to the will of the flesh, because they are born of God. Tonight, I want to give every person that's watching, that's in this house, or maybe listening to the CD or this DVD afterwards, the opportunity to come and say, Jesus, I want to receive You with my whole heart. I don't want to have any reservations. I want to receive You totally and wholly. Save me completely. Romans, if He now saved us, how will He not save us in the future now that we are believers? So God wants to set you totally free, but you got to totally receive Him. It's so simple. It's so simple. If I believe in my heart and confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and that God raised Him from the dead, I shall be saved. It doesn't mean born again. It means born again plus saved and saved and saved and saved and saved. I remember when I was born again. I was there. I got up the next day. Everything was different. Grass was green, sky was blue, I could hear the birds singing, everything was changed. But I had a habit called smoking. the nicotine devil. For 4 years, I struggled to get rid of it because I had reservations, because I said, while I was getting born again, I was thinking how I was going to smoke when I come out of the church. Now, I'm just talking to people who smoked or smoking. Other people will not understand it. But maybe you got another habit. Maybe it's coffee. That caffeine is just as addicted. Maybe it's tea. It just gets... Maybe... I don't know. Eating. Cursing. Lust. Anger. It's all addictions. There's a book. Codependence. Codependence. There's something that you need to be dependent upon except Christ Himself. In other words, you depend on something that puts adrenaline in your body, and if you don't do it, it feels like you're not complete, and most people don't know it. It's called addictions. But I admitted, Lord, I need freedom. I cried, I wept. Until one day a man came, put his hands on me, and spoke a word of freedom into my life. And I was free. But then I struggled with people. If people didn't receive the word that I had, I was always like, why can't he receive this word? You know, like, you know, if you're better than me, you're too spiritual. If you're lower than me, you're too unspiritual. Everybody's judged according to my spirituality. Till somebody one day came and spoke a word of freedom into my life, and I was free. And I trust tonight will be such a night. There's a rock and roll song that says such a night, but that's not the one we're talking about. Just such a night tonight. May God set us all free from everything that the law could not set us free from. Justify us from everything that we could not be justified from. Deliver us from everything that we could not be delivered from. May grace come tonight. As I have spoken and read the word and commended you to the grace of God, and spoke the word of blessing unto you, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Be gracious unto you. And spoke the other blessing unto you. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May something start happening tonight as you open your heart and say, Jesus, I'm going to receive you. I'm going to have no reservations. Every single area of my life, spirit, soul, and body. Jesus, I make you Lord of every area. My emotions, my habits, my finances, my life, my marriage, everything. Jesus, you must be Lord from tonight. And your grace must invade every area. Imagine the freedom. Imagine the peace. Imagine the joy. Let's pray. Everybody that can hear me and you want to do it, say, Lord Jesus Christ, I confess you as my Lord. I confess you as my Savior. Come into my whole life, my spirit, my soul, and my body. I give you complete control. I entrust myself, Kobus van Rensburg. Everything that I is, everything that I am, everything that I have, everything that I do, I commit it unto your Lordship. Jesus, as the Christ, come take complete control. Tonight, I receive your grace. Things that'll be difficult to understand will come into my life tonight. total freedom, total salvation, total healing, total prosperity, total victory, total deliverance, total supply, total provision, total protection by your grace in Jesus' name. Now speak your stuff that you want the grace of God to hit. Lord, this thing in my life, that thing in my life, this finances, this marriage, this business, this work situation, this virus in my body, this cancer, this habit, this addiction, whatever. Come on, the song is nearly 100 years old. Reach out and touch the Lord as He passes by. You'll find
is not to be seen.
To hear your heart's cry.
To hear your heart's
He's passing cry. By this moment.
He's passing. And by this moment,
your needs to supply.
Your needs to
come on, reach out.
So reach out and touch the Lord.
Come on.
As He passes.
That's unscriptural. Jesus is not passing by, He's with us forever. Hey. Moments are passing by. Opportunities are passing by. Situations are passing by. This is a situation. This is an opportunity that can you not let by. Now you're going to go home and watch TV. Then you start not sitting under the word of grace. Right now I've been preaching to you the word of grace. We're going to reach out. We're going to start coming to the front. And I'm going to start laying hands on you. And I'm going to say grace, grace, grace. Grace, no matter if it's healing, provision, deliverance, grace, grace. Jesus, Jesus.
And touch the Lord as He passes by. Reach out and touch the Lord as He passes by. Find is not too busy to hear your heart's cry. He is passing by this moment. Your needs to survive. So reach out.
Grace.
Great.